7. I'm going to read down through verse 14. So verse 7, it reads, "But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I suffer the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ, and he be found in me, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus." Then he says, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." Amen. Amen. And so as I began to think about, even in this passage of scripture where he says, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. Paul is saying that he wants to know Christ to the fullest extent, right? He wants to be conformed into the image of Christ. He wants to be conformed into this place of knowing him in that way, even unto the place of his death. It says in the ESV version, I don't know, Kari, you pull up the ESV version, it says, becoming like him in his death. Amen? And so this is the goal. And part of my message today is one of the things I want us to talk about is knowing our identity. And as we enter into this new season, into this new year, a lot of times we're making New Year's resolutions. We're trying to, attain something. We're trying to achieve something. And Paul says that he presses, this is the thing that he's trying to attain, right? This is the place that he's trying to go. This is the mark. This is the goal that he's reaching toward, is so that he can be made into the likeness of Christ, right? He's even unto his death, right? And so most of the time when we're thinking about prospering, when we're thinking about moving toward a place, when we're thinking about improving our lives, doing better, making our New Year's resolutions, we're thinking about something that's going to be prosperous, that's going to be blessing to us. But if, like Paul says here, if we begin to start thinking about, I just want to be like Christ, even to the place of suffering, right? It's more important for me to be like Christ than it is for me to have any other benefit in life, right? It's more important for me to be like Christ, even if it's at the cost of me suffering. It's more important for me to be like Christ, even if it's at the cost of me giving my life, even if it's the cost of death, right? This is what Paul is saying, is that this is the goal. He says, I'm not saying that I've attained this place yet. I've not arrived yet. But he says that he's pressing toward this place, right? I press toward the mark of the high calling, right? It's a high calling. Where is that high calling? It's in Christ Jesus. Amen. Because if we really begin to see what God did through this process of Jesus's life in the earth and then his death on the cross, then his resurrection from the dead, that was a process, right? It was a process of going through trials in life, right? It was a process of even dying, even unto his flesh, right? But then it says that because of he humbled him, he thought it not robbery to be equal with God, right? So he understood who he was. He knew his identity. He knew that he was God. He even told folks that he was God, right? He knew his identity. He didn't think it was robbery to be equal with God, right? But he suffered. He humbled himself even unto death, right? And then it says that, the Bible says that, that then God elevated him. He was his name. He had been given all authority, and his name was higher than any other name. Right? That at the name of Jesus, every knee has to bow, right? Every tongue has to confess that he's Lord, right? But that all happened through the process of him giving his life, right? Of him humbling himself. So our process for growth, our process for prosperity, our process for finding this place of authority and blessing and favor, it's all wrapped in our identity in Christ. And this is what Paul is saying. He says, hey, my true place of eternal glory is found in this place of finding my identity in Christ. He presses toward the mark of that place. Amen. Hallelujah. And many of us, we're so concerned about what is my calling in life? What is my purpose in life? What am I going to do? How can I be successful? What legacy can I leave, right? What can I attain in life? And this is as we begin to start assessing ourselves at the end of the year, start thinking about New Year's resolutions. You know, a lot of that stuff starts going through our head, right? It's like, hey, I need to lose weight. I need to do all these things, right? I need to get myself together. Amen. And so as we begin to start thinking about our identity, I think there's three areas that we need to think about. Like, who are we as it relates to God, as we relate to God? Who are we as we relate to the church and the earth, right? And who are we as we relate to the world? I think as we think about these things, as we think about our identity, we should think about our identity on these three different dimensions, because ultimately everything's wrapped in those three areas. Who we are in our relationship to God, who we are, where do we fit in the church, and how do we relate to the world. And so what happens is, I believe that we all as believers, we all have that identity in some form or fashion, right? Because we all are children of God. We all have been reconciled back to God, right? We all are in the body of Christ, right? We all have a ministry to the world. And so we need to begin to understand that and what that means, what that looks like in a greater way. And so some of the challenges that will prevent us from really understanding that is the enemy will bring the spirit of rejection. I think rejection is the enemy of true identity, right? Rejection, the spirit of rejection comes to be the enemy of purpose and destiny. And the spirit of rejection can begin even in the womb. The spirit of rejection can come even from the disappointment that a mother has about being pregnant, or the decision to going back and forth, if she wants to have an abortion or not. Or it can come even from the father of saying, hey, I'm not the father, that's not my baby, right? That spirit of rejection can find a way in, can find a seed in that place. Amen. And so it can take root within the family, and even how, you know, we relate to each other even in family, right? So even throughout the years, feeling like I'm the oldest child, so I have to do everything. I have to be responsible for everyone. I'm the middle child, so nobody pays attention to me, right? Or I'm the youngest child, or, you know, that, you know, people said always treat me like the baby, or never let me do anything by myself, or that sort of, right? You can find all those different scenarios where rejection can take root. And so we begin to start understanding, even as we go through this place of adolescence, we go through this place of, you know, becoming into, stepping into adulthood and really trying to identify, you know, what's wrong with me, right? Now, my parents messed me up, right? And so we point a lot of fingers at our parents and say, you know, all the things that our parents didn't do and all those things, right? Until we realize that, okay, you know, that may be true, but I still got to take care of me, right? I still have to live my life, right? I still have to, nobody's going to come and do it for me. I remember my old boss said that one time to me. I don't know, it's just something that just, it's something, you know how sometimes people say things to you and it just sticks? It's just like, man, it's just kind of like something, I don't know, prophetic or whatever. And it was really nothing deep. We were just kind of talking about like doing taxes and doing stuff like that. Then you just say, yep, because nobody's going to do it for you, right? You know, like figure it out, you know, because sometimes things can get complicated, right? Things can get complicated with, you know, budgeting your finances and budgeting and figuring out, like, you know, your tax situation, all these things. And we're looking at all these people. And I think maybe what caused me to think that way is because I'm around a lot of people who I knew were doing much better, right, financially. And so sometimes we can see the look at those people and think, oh, wow, you know, they got a silver spoon, right? Or they have something that's different that happened in their life. They had an advantage, right? Or something to that nature. And I think that was really maybe even the intent of that comment was to say that, no, we all got to do it for ourselves, right? It's really just being a man, right? This is really, you know, I'm speaking to the few men that are in here, right? It's just, you know, sometimes you just have to man up, right? It's just, you got to man up because this is your life. Right, you have to become an adult, right? And there's some point, at some point, in spite of all the stuff that happened to you, right, in your life, and when you were a kid, and all these things that happened, there is a point in your life where if you keep using that as an excuse, it's going to cripple you, right? It's going to handicap, you're going to be limited, you're going to be capped off. Your potential is going to be limited. But as soon as you get the revelation that says, in spite of people wanting to baby, so this is a man thing, right? This is the reason why the Bible says leave and cleave, right? And so you have to get to a place where you discover that, hey, as much as my mama want to help me, I got to help myself, right? As much as my mom wants to take care of me and let me, you know, stay in the house and do all these things, there has to be an inner drive within myself that's going to say, hey, I don't want to be taken care of because I'm a man, right? Or I'm an adult. This applies to women too, right? I don't want to, as much as my parents love me, as much as my mom wants to take care of me and baby me, that don't feel good to me. There's something that's perverted about that. Right? It's almost like, ugh, right? It's almost like, that's perverted, right? Because there is an inner drive that says, hey, I want to be my own man. And sometimes it's to our demise, right? Sometimes it's like, you'd be like, yeah, well, but you're going to, you know, you're going to be broke or you're going to be, but sometimes we have to learn these lessons, right? Because it's still more important for me to find my identity, me to be whole, me to walk into my purpose than it is for me to be taken care of. Amen. There's a greater value in that. And sometimes it takes, and this is what adolescence does. Adolescence is where you're having a hard time figuring that part out, right? It's kind of like I need help, but I don't need help. I want to ask for help because I really do need help, but then there are some things that I don't want to ask for help, right? And there's certain things that, and so the parent and the child are both trying to figure that out, right? You're trying to balance that out. And so it's a place of growth. It's a place of of launching and moving into their identity. And I think it's key here because Paul says, I'm pressing toward the mark of pain, right? I press toward the mark of not feeling good. I press toward the mark of wholeness. I press toward the mark of what's the right thing to do. I press toward the mark of what's of my purpose, of who I'm supposed to be. I press toward the mark of the Spirit of God that's on the inside of me that's moving me toward this place. I mean, all of the apostles figured this out when they, it says, the Bible says in Revelation, that they love their lives, they love not their lives unto the death. Because they loved who they were called to be more than they cared about their lives. And this is really the message of the gospel, is to love who you're called to be, love where God's taking you more than you care about the cares of the world, than you care about your even your own life. Amen. That's not abnormal when it comes to the kingdom way of thinking, when it comes to spirituality, when it comes to the Spirit of God, that's normal. But the world wants to come and cause pain, cause rejection, and cause all these things that wants to cause us to cling to these natural things. And so we have to understand that there's going to be resistance. There's going to be rejection. There's going to be, the enemy is going to tempt you in a way of making you feel like you're going to be all by yourself, right? This is what he's trying to do so that he won't, so that you won't leave and cleave, so that you won't, and I'm using leave and cleave as a marriage analogy, right? But he's saying the enemy wants to bring rejection so that you will stay in that place of stagnation, so that you will stay in that place where you won't grow. Amen. Because you're like, oh, but that person hurts me, but you're, and so you want to feel affirmed by that person as opposed to just pressing toward the mark. Amen. Amen. And so this is, so we need to find our place of purpose and our destiny as we press toward the mark. And so the spirit of rejection can begin early. And so the battle of knowing your identity can be a fight between individuality and the need to feel connected or affirmed, right? And so this is why adolescence can be so difficult. We need to find our individual uniqueness, but we still need the love and affection of our family. So we still need love and affection from our family and people around us, but we need to find our individual uniqueness at the same time. And so this is the pressing, and as we press toward God, he helps us in this process, right? And so because it's such a sensitive time, and it's such a sensitive place, feelings of rejection can send you over the deep end. And so we have to be aware of our enemy. We have to be aware of the battle, the challenge that comes with this. We know a couple of people in the Bible who experienced this. We know David experienced this, right, with his brothers, right? When Samuel came to look for the next king, right? He went through all the brothers, right? And Jesse, they didn't even have him come up and stand with the other brothers, right? They had him out in the back somewhere playing with the sheep, right? Tending the sheep, right? He could have been playing with them too, but he was out in the back, right? Tending the sheep, right? And so, so they didn't even acknowledge him in that way, but he had great purpose. But he had to go through a process of rejection, right? And then even when he was able to confront, he wanted to confront Goliath, right? Which was key, right? All the things that, it was key because God, first of all, had already identified David as the next king, right? And so there was a resistance even within his own family to prevent him from walking into this place of destiny, right? If he would have got into the place of saying, hey, I need to feel affirmed by my family, then he would have missed his calling. He would have missed his purpose, right? If he would have got into that place, even when he wanted to confront Goliath, his brothers tried to convince him that he shouldn't be there, right? He was like, go back home. What are you doing here, right? Amen. And so there was a very noticeable place of rejection, amen, as he began to try to fulfill his assignment. We know that with Nehemiah, right? Nehemiah was given an apostolic assignment to build the wall, to rebuild the wall of Jerusalem. And he got mocked. He got talked about by Sanballat. He got talked about by, you know, they were just mocking him and talking about him and saying, hey, why don't you come over here and help us do this? And he knew what his assignment was, right? He didn't allow rejection to get him off the wall. He didn't allow fear to bring him down off of that wall. Amen? And we know Joseph had this same challenge, right? Joseph was called by God to be a prophet and to lead his family into a place of blessing. This is Joseph's call. Remember, Joseph had a dream, and his brothers was like, man, what's going on? He got a dream that he was going to be elevated over his family, right? And then they were like, man, what's going on? Then he had another dream, right, that he was elevated over, you know, not only just his brothers, but his mom and his dad too, right? And they were like, okay, now you've gone too far. Even the dad was like, no. Even Jacob was like, now you've gone too far, right? And so in Genesis chapter 47, Genesis chapter 47, verse 1 through 6, this is ESV that I'm reading from. It says, so Joseph went in and told Pharaoh, my father and my brothers with their flocks and herds and all that they possess have come from the land of Canaan. They are now in the land of Goshen, and from among his brothers he took five men and presented them to Pharaoh. Pharaoh said to his brothers, what is your occupation? And they said to Pharaoh, your servants are shepherds, as our fathers were. They said to Pharaoh, we have come to sojourn in the land, and there is no pasture for your servants' flocks, for the famine is severe in the land of Canaan. Now, please let your servants dwell in the land of Goshen. Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, your father and your brothers have come to you. The land of Egypt is before you. Settle your father and your brothers in the best of the land. Let them settle in the land of Goshen. And if you know any able men among them, put them in charge of my livestock. So I'm sure at some point Joseph realized how important his position was in relationship to his family, right? He realized that, wow, this is why God put me in this position for such a time as this, right? He realized that, wow, this is why God took me through all of this heartache, all of this struggle, all of this rejection, right? So that I can come up and be my own man, so that I can come up and be a leader, so that I can come up and lead my people into this place of blessing. But rejection was part of that process. Amen? And so he came to that place as he went through it with God, right? As he went through it, believing and trusting and relying on the leading of God through this process, he was able to come through it in a place of authority and power. And so I'm sure that he understood that it was important for him to go through this process to deliver his family, to bring his family into this place of blessing. But he probably had no idea how important that it was in relation to the church, even today. Because Joseph going through that place had no idea, he couldn't see, you know, the church today and all of that dynamics of us being in this building and all the things that the church does today, right? I mean, he may have been able to see some things prophetically, but I'm sure he wasn't able to see all of the and understand all of the things that how it impacted the church today, right? Because really, why am I saying that? Because Joseph was he was not only called to be a prophet, But he was a key apostolic person who was able to position his family to not just be a family, but be a nation, right? And it was key that they were moved into that place of Goshen so they can grow and expand and be a nation of Israel. That was a key. Their physical location and positioning was key to them growing to become the nation of Israel. Why is that important to the church today? Because the nation of Israel, right, was a prototype. It was a shadow. It was something that God was doing in the earth through the nation of Israel so that we could be the church today. Yeah. Amen. And so this is why it's important to embrace our differences. If Joseph would have said, hey, I just want to be like my brothers, amen, it could have set a whole different course, right? If Joseph would have just said, hey, I'm different, I'm unique, and maybe something's wrong with me, right? Maybe because I'm just a weirdo, right? Maybe because I'm just so different because I'm having these dreams and visions, and because I'm a weirdo, I need to go sit in the corner somewhere by myself, amen? He would have been completely off course. It would have set a different course for even us as a church today, amen? And so this is why it's important to embrace our differences, knowing that our uniqueness does not necessarily mean that we're weird, but it can be a gift used for a special purpose. And so we should ask ourselves, who are we as it relates to God? Romans 3, and I'm just going to read through. You don't have to pull them all up, but I'm going to read through a few scriptures. Romans 3, 21 through 22, it says, but now the righteousness of God has been manifest apart from the law. Although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe, for there is no distinction. So for the believer, for all of us who are believers in Jesus Christ, who are we as a group, as a whole, broadly, we are the righteousness of God because we are the apple of his eye. We have been justified by God. We have been made right by God. Amen. We are holy. He says, be ye holy as I am holy. Amen. We have the capability to be all that God has, all that Jesus had in him. Amen. In the earth. Amen. We have the ability to be a light. Amen. To the rest of the world. Amen. Romans 5:10 says, for if while we were sinners, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more now have we been reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. And so we have been reconciled, right? We have, even though that we lived in a place where we're thinking different, living different, that we have been far from God, we feel like we're not connected with heaven. And so I believe this is something that we should be reminded of, even as it relates to God, as it relates to heaven, is that we are seated in heavenly places with him, right? We are in a place where we are in a place where we can hear God, see God, feel God, experience God. We're not in a place where we're distant from God. Why? Because the Bible says we've been reconciled to him through Jesus Christ. Amen. We have to get that out of our minds, just thinking that, oh, I don't want to get up and pray because I feel like I'm far from God. Amen. Many of us who are believers, we're feeling like, you know, we live in this place of, you know, we got to go through this religious routine to be connected or feel like we're close with God. We got to be in this complete environment where there's, a thousand people in the room and, you know, praise and worship is going really good and somebody prophesies. So, you know, we got to have all these ingredients, and which is really man-made religious formulas when we really, all we have to do is believe that God has reconciled us back to him. Amen? And so when we believe that we've been reconciled to God, that means that we're in a place, that means that we can be in our heavenly seat. Amen. Romans 5:8, it says, but God shows his love for us, and that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. And so not only does God love us, we can know that we're loved by God. It says that he demonstrated that by sending Christ, right? He's not just, it's not just a talk, right? Just like he demonstrated that when to Jesus Christ, that when he gave his life on the cross, that he was going to make his name higher than any other name, right? That at the name of Jesus, every tongue will confess, every knee will bow. Amen. That's at the name of Jesus, now that he's forever making intercession for us in heaven, right? That he lives today to make intercession for us, right? That he rose from the dead, that he showed Thomas the holes in his hands, right? That he appeared to the disciples. He appeared to like 120 folks after his resurrection from the dead, and he walked amongst the earth, right? That he gave testimony that he rose from the dead, and that he's forever making intercession for us even today. Amen. That same power is in us. Amen. That same power he demonstrated to Jesus, that if he gave his life, he was going to give him full authority. He's demonstrated that to us, his love toward us, that Jesus died on the cross, that he shows that he loves us. And so we should also ask, how do we fit into the body of Christ? Ephesians 2:10, it says, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has before ordained that we should walk in them." So we're his workmanship. How do we fit into the body of Christ? Why are we a part of the body of Christ? Because there's still work to do in the earth. Jesus said that the works that I do, you shall do also in greater works. He says that he came to, the Bible says that the work of Jesus Christ was to come to destroy the works of the devil. He said, "Pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in the earth the same way that it is in heaven." Amen. This is the assignment of the church, is to bring heaven into the earth, or to demonstrate the kingdom of God in the earth, and we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works. Just like when he created Adam to take care of the earth, the same way that like it is in heaven. Amen. Ephesians 2:19, it says, "Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto a holy temple in the Lord, in whom ye also are builded together for a habitation of God through the Spirit." And so he said that we're no longer strangers and aliens, but we are fellow citizens with the saints in the household of God. And so how do we relate as a church? How do we relate to the church? Well, we're citizens, amen, of the kingdom of God. We're citizens of the family of God. We're citizens of a foundation. We're citizens. We're a part of a temple. You are a temple. We are the temple of God. Amen. This is how we fit into the church. Amen. In 2 Timothy 2, it says, "Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, who shall be able to teach others also. Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangle himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who has chosen him to be a soldier." Amen. We're soldiers of Christ, right? We're soldiers in the kingdom of God. We have to know our identity, as not only as it relates to God, but as it relates to the church. You're called to be a soldier. Amen. This is not just something I just make up because it's like something I like to say. Amen. It's the reason why I'm reading all these scriptures to us, right? It's because this is something that the Bible is telling us that we are, right? He's saying that, you know, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. We should also ask ourselves how we should relate to the world around us. And we have to recognize that we are all loved by God, and we should respond to that love by showing our love back by enlisting in the army of the Lord, becoming a good soldier for God. Those are just the key things that every believer should do. Every believer should understand that we reconcile back to God. Every believer should understand that we're loved by God. Every believer should understand that we are a soldier of God, right? Soldier of Christ, right? But then when it comes into our uniqueness, God uses our uniqueness to do ministry to the world, right? And so this is the reason why even in 1 Corinthians 12, starting at verse 4, 1 Corinthians 12, starting at verse 4, 4 through 12, it says, Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And so it's talking about gifts. It's just talking about your individual gifts or gifts of the Spirit that's working through individuals, right? Administrations is talking about leadership gifts or the gifts of Christ, okay? It's talking about the gifts of Christ, which is in Ephesians 4, which is because when we read Ephesians 4, it says, now Christ has given gifts to men. It says Christ gave those gifts to men, right? Some apostles, some prophets, pastors, evangelists, teachers, right? And for the perfecting of the saints. So those are administrative gifts or leadership gifts to edify the body of Christ, right? And then it says there's gifts of the Spirit, and those are, you know, that comes from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit releases different gifts, right? And he says, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with all. And so everybody should have the Holy Spirit for the purpose of profiting or for the purpose of being a benefit to everyone. It's so that we all have the ability to do ministry as the Holy Spirit works through us. So that means that anybody that's around you can benefit because the Holy Spirit that's manifesting itself through you, right? And so it says, for to one is given the Spirit of the word of wisdom, one another the word of knowledge, the same Spirit, another faith by the same Spirit, another Spirit, gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another working of miracles, another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another diverse kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But all these worketh that one in the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will. For the body is one and hath many members, and all of the members of that body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. And so what am I saying? So our work within the church is an offering to the Lord as we serve one another to edify the body. Our ministry work to the world is an offering to the Lord as we use our unique gifts and the gifts of the Holy Spirit to evangelize to the world. And so it's all working together as it's all wrapped up in our identity in Christ. I'm saying that because there's a lot of, as we begin to start understanding our identity, we have an identity just as a believer, right? And we have an identity as a unique believer as it relates to doing ministry to the world, but it's all wrapped up in our identity in Christ. This is the reason why Paul said, I press toward the mark of the high calling, which is in Christ Jesus. It's all wrapped up in Jesus. It's all wrapped up in giving our lives to Jesus. And there is some uniqueness, just like Joseph had uniqueness, just like David had uniqueness, just like Daniel had uniqueness, right? But it was all for the purpose of the kingdom of God. It was all for the purpose of the glory of God. And it says in Romans 8, 28, it says, and we know all things work together for the good, right? So all these, there various different things, whether it be, you know, gifts of administration, whether it be the gifts of Christ, whether it be the gifts of the Holy Spirit, whether it be just your individual uniqueness gift that you have, is all working together for the good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. Amen. And so when we think about identity, when we think about who we are, where we're going, what we're doing, it's all wrapped up in our identity in Christ. And God's not going to take away your uniqueness. God's not going to take away, but we just have to have the right perspective of it, right? We have to have the right understanding of it. We have to have the right, we have to put it into the right perspective, put it into the right box, put it into the right understanding, and you will find fulfillment in that place. You will find fulfillment into that place of living your life according to his purpose, according to your love toward him. Amen. Hallelujah. Lord God, we just thank you. Hallelujah. We're going to sing that. Go ahead and play that song, that last song you were going to play. God, we just thank you, God. God, that you have a calling, that you have a purpose for us. God, and we're stepping into that in this year of 2022. We're moving into, God, all of what you have for us. And we're just excited about the uniqueness, about the differences that will come out, about the different gifts, God, that are going to manifest, God, as we submit our lives to you. When, so we just receive that. We just walk into that. We step into that by faith. And we come against fear. We come against rejection. We come against unbelief. We just press through all those things and we press towards you. And we receive you to make us into your image. In Jesus' name.